He first served in 2011 and takes on the mantle of leadership for the second time today. More on Andrew Michael Holness's journey to Jamaica House later in the show. Hello, I'm Adrian Atkinson and you're inside Jamaica Magazine. Much more is on the agenda, so please stick around. Andrea Chisholm has the day's news right after this quick break.
Jamaica, a logistics-centered economy. Global investors investing in mega projects. Special Economic Zone Act approved by Parliament. Jamaica is ready for increased global trade. Thousands of Jamaicans across the country, from high school to higher learning, trained in logistics management. More ships refueling in Jamaica and increased logistics operations in Jamaica. Capacity building for the business sector. The Jamaica Logistics Hub Initiative, rolling out across the country.
Good day, I'm Andrea Chisholm and this is your GIS News for Thursday, March 3. Andrew Holness is Jamaica's new Prime Minister. Mr. Holness was sworn into office for the second time earlier today, having first held the post from October 2011 to January 2012. His appointment this time follows the Jamaica Labour Party's 32-31 seat victory over the People's National Party in the February 25 general elections. Prime Minister Holness received the instrument of appointment from Governor-General Sir Patrick Allen in a ceremony at King's House this afternoon. We have more on the leader's journey to Jamaica House later in the magazine. On to other news now, the Ministry of Education has expressed confidence that it will reach its target of achieving mastery in numeracy for primary school students by the year 2018. This in light of the progress made thus far and the systems that have been put in place.
Well, we had interim targets set for each year, and we have actually exceeded the interim target for 2015. We continue to work with the schools, focusing mainly on building teacher capacity. Our coaches are still out, and our specialists, they work more closely with those schools that don't have the support of coaches. We're just focusing on the goal and working towards meeting it.
Math educators can access the ministry's website for relevant material and activities to guide their teaching. In the meantime, the ministry's National Mathematics Coordinator says the Primary Exit Profile, PEP, will change the way mathematics is taught in schools. The PEP is the new examination that will replace the Grade 6 Achievement Test and is to feature more practical components in the curriculum.
The Primary Exit Profile will have a component that will have higher order thinking items. So the shift will move away from knowledge and recall and to problem solving and reasoning. That is what I think is going to significantly push the change across the system.
PEP's curriculum is expected to be rolled out in schools starting September. The National Works Agency, NWA, says it's far advanced in its work to clear several critical drains and roadways in St. James, which were adversely affected by flood rains over the weekend. Community Relations Officer at the NWA's Western Region, Janelle Ricketts, says full access has been restored to all roadways in St. James. Efforts are now being concentrated on the cleaning of critical drains, in particular the north and south gullies in the city of Montego Bay. The NWA is also targeting sections of several roadways in Hanover which were affected by landslides. The agency is also working to clear a section of the Riley River which was impacted by washed down debris. The University of the West Indies has received $90,000 in grant funding from Japan for the construction of a gymnasium. The gymnasium will be used primarily for the development of artistic gymnastics at the institution and is to be completed within the next 3 months. As part of the support, Japanese coaches from Nishida's gymnastics will help with the training of gymnasts at the facility. UWI's Pro Vice Chancellor and Principal Professor Archibald MacDonald says the successful completion of the project is another critical step in the university's ongoing mandate to diversify its capabilities and program offerings. He says the facility will likely encourage more interest in gymnastics among students and the wider public. And finally, the Jamaica Aid Support for Life, JASL, has launched a media campaign to end violence against women and girls. Dubbed Our Vision for Women by Women, it's part of a project called Expanding Gains to Decrease and Prevent Violence Against Women in the Context of HIV and AIDS. The project is funded by the United Nations Trust Fund to End Violence Against Women and involved training and engaging with over 1,000 women in various socioeconomic groups. It is expected that the media campaign will raise awareness about the matter of violence against women being one of the factors that contribute to females' vulnerability to contracting HIV.
HIV risk and violence is both direct and indirect. And we know directly because through forced intercourse with an HIV-infected individual leads to HIV transmission. And indirectly, because of the psychosocial stress that is put onto the woman, and it often leads to later engagement in high-risk behaviors.
Jamaica AIDS Support's executive director says the media campaign will challenge the social acceptance of violence against women.
By placing pressure on the Jamaican people, the government, to dialogue, to act, and of course to strengthen the institutional response to address violence against women, particularly in the sectors of health, law enforcement, justice, and of course the social sector.
The tagline for the media campaign is hashtag zero vor zero HIV. And that's it for GIS News today. Amandra Chisholm, thank you for watching.
This is the Aedes aegypti mosquito that spreads the Zika, chikungunya, and dengue viruses. Search for its breeding sites and destroy them. A message from the Ministry of Health.
Andrew Michael Holness was sworn in as Jamaica's ninth Prime Minister on October 23, 2011. Earlier today, he again received the instrument of appointment to the office of a Prime Minister. It is yet another seminal moment in a life spent serving in the classroom, chambers of Parliament, and the Cabinet. We have more on his journey to Jamaica House next.
I, Andrew Michael Holness, do swear that I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to Jamaica, that I will uphold and defend the Constitution and the laws of Jamaica, and that I will conscientiously and impartially discharge my responsibilities to the people of Jamaica. So help me God.
A 35-year-old Andrew Holness boldly taking on the task of setting the country's education system to rights. Many say they could see that Andrew Holness was destined for leadership from his early years as a young student.
We are not surprised because he said so many times in classes, his classmates said so, and even for the school magazine, that's what is listed there, that his ambition is to be a politician.
Youth is not an impediment if it is put to serve the right ends. I've known other young people who were more interested in serving themselves in politics. But Andrew is one that I think is not in that category. He's someone who is more focused on the national affairs of the country.
Born on July 21, 1972, Andrew Michael Holness grew up in Spanish Town, St. Catherine. Young Andrew attended the Spanish Town Primary School and later the St. Catherine High School, where he served as head boy, president of the Students' Council and the Debating Society.
He was very focused, determined, and hardworking. Very sharp analytical skills. Very sharp, and he would be able to argue points, he would be able to introduce new ideas into the discussion. So I would say he was widely read.
That engaging mind was further developed at the University of the West Indies, where he pursued a Bachelor of Sciences degree in Management Studies, and later a Master of Sciences in Governance and Public Policy. He taught briefly at his St. Catherine alma mater, but it was a two-year tenure as executive director of the Voluntary Organization for the Upliftment of Children, VOUCH, which propelled Mr. Holness into the political arena. It was there that he came into contact with a man credited for introducing him to politics. According to former Prime Minister Edward Siaga, Holness stood out at VOUCH.
It's not usual to find young men in those kind of situations because it's a area in which you are trained to give and to give support and to give assistance. And men are not that caring. If it was a woman in the position, I could more have understood it. So to me, it was a unique situation.
Full political baptism was to follow in 1997, when Mr. Holness was elected Member of Parliament for West Central St. Andrew. In the years that followed, he held shadow portfolios for land and development, housing and education, roles that helped prepare him for higher levels of leadership. After the JLP's victory at the polls in 2007, Mr. Holness was given the job to manage the country's education system. His passion for education was evident.
If you want to see the future of Jamaica, look at your children. If you want to know what the future of Jamaica will be, look at the decisions that we are making now.
Mr. Holness led the Education Ministry for 4 years, and from all accounts, he reaped much success. Improvements in literacy, school safety and security, and a greater accountability among school administrators. Described as a transformational leader by those who have worked closely with him, Mr. Holness took on the task of reform, aiming to effectively place education in a position to change the nation.
We believe that it is a school in partnership with the family and the church that will shape the Jamaican society to be the place of choice to live, work, raise families, and do business.
He has his own mind. He uses it. He's firm in what he does. And therefore, he will make decisions and can make the right decisions with good due consideration. Now, those are the tools you need to handle problems.
I, Andrew Michael Holness, do solemnly, sincerely, and truly declare and affirm that I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to Jamaica, that I will uphold and defend the Constitution and the laws of Jamaica, and that I will conscientiously and impartially discharge my responsibilities to the people of Jamaica.
Nutritious food, succulent dishes, superior workmanship, and excellent service. Jamaica is on the go. Let's grow what we eat and eat what we grow. Let's harness the indomitable spirit of our most valued resource, our people. Let's support our local businesses. After all, buying Jamaican means building Jamaica.
We shift gears now to focus on developments in our agricultural sector. First up, the perennial larceny prevention unit's success in curtailing farm theft.
On the ground, in the field, meeting with farmers and stakeholders, government's perennial larceny prevention unit has been working aggressively to put a dent in the theft of farm animals and produce. This intense campaign by the Ministry of Agriculture, aided by the police, has led to a 14% reduction of farm thefts from the establishment of the unit in March 2015 to October of the same year. During that period, the division had 133 prosecutions, resulting in 125 convictions. Officers also seized and disposed of over 4,200 pounds of uncertified meat and recovered more than 190 stolen animals.
We're going around this island and letting people know that work is being done, and we're working for the farmers to ensure that you feel safe, you are protected, and that you are reassured.
I think the SP Francis and his crew have done a fairly good job.
With that commendation, the work continues. On one of the farm visits, DSP Francis indicated that among the strategies being looked at was the publishing of repeat offenders' names. The meeting was also used to inform farmers about some of the things they could do to mitigate thefts.
We have the very common, the dog. Get a dog put on the farm. You also can put up camera systems to ensure that you have a good view of what is happening around your area and around the farm. If you have farm animals, we have seen persons use the bell system. You put a bell around the neck of the animal, so if they are moved or if there's any slight movement, it triggers a sound system that will alert you as the farmer. We have seen the more sophisticated method of the tagging of the animals, the tattooing of animals. These are all methods that are used.
Farmers are also coming up with their own solutions, such as implementing the farm watch system.
Presence of persons doing surveillance on the farm, I think that helps to cut back on the predator larceny, because persons wouldn't take the chance coming in knowing that there are persons watching the farm.
And as farmers, you can look out for each other as well. That's the best way to go about protecting yourselves against each other and against predator thieves.
If we come together and try to stamp out predator larceny, I think it is for the betterment of all of us in the industry.
The police officers used the opportunity to appeal to farmers who use different sets of workers for reaping and related activities to create a database to safeguard their businesses.
You also need to ensure that you get the relevant names, next of kin. You also need to ensure you have background checks where necessary on the employees that are employed to your operations. By doing so, you will create a system where persons may feel a sense of being caught if they take the chance to steal your produce.
And to protect consumers, he urged for warning signs to be up when produce has been sprayed. Members of the Predator Larceny Prevention Unit visited over 100 farms and held more than 70 community meetings in 2015. These are aimed at getting farmers to work more closely with each other and the police to build a stronger resistance against thieves. It is at these meetings that the concerns of farmers are addressed.
How can you protect us going the right way, producing our produce that the end customer knows that it's coming not from a stolen area or that it's not affected by chemicals or anything.
We're speaking about traceability. How can you know where your produce is coming from? The system that the government have in place currently have to do with the receipt system. The Jamaica Agricultural Society have a receipt system that accounts for the produce that you buy and the person who has it in their possession, where they get it from. We're trying to establish this kind of system across the country.
The farmers were also assured that while two persons were charged with coordinating the unit's activities from a national level, resources were drawn from all police divisions.
In each parish, the operation officer is responsible for predator larceny and responsible for treating with those reports. We want to reassure you that the Jamaica Constabulary Force Predator Larceny Prevention Unit is here to provide you with the relevant support to take action where necessary for you to carry on with your business of farming and feeding the nation. We want you to continue to reap what you grow.
It is this level of commitment by the government plus the support of farmers which will allow us to see more reductions in predator larceny, achieving a targeted priority of safety and security for both farmers and consumers.
Got animation skills? Then come on out to Kingston 2016 and show off your talent. It's March 12 and 13 at the Edna Manley College of the Visual and Performing Arts. There will be amazing prizes, a film festival, animation competitions, seminars, and pitch competitions. Come and learn from the best local and international animation experts and engage investors in speed meetings. Kingston 2016, March 12 and 13, put on by the Ministry of Science, Technology, Energy, and Mining. Key partners include the World Bank, Caribbean Development Bank, Jampro, Toon Boom, TV Paint Development, Wacom, Ezirom, the Jamaica Information Service, and Edna Manley College of the Visual and Performing Arts.
As our focus on agriculture continues, we now look at measures to enable sustainable production of pig for the local market.
In 2012, government implemented a supply management regime to reduce the importation of pork meat. And today, the Ministry of Agriculture is reporting steady growth in the pork industry. Pork imports reduced by more than 38% at the end of 2014, coming from imports of over 3 million kilograms in 2011. The period also showed no imports of finished ham or pig parts for the production of ham. This has helped to secure the investments of local pig farmers. And to ensure that the local demand is satisfied, the Agriculture Ministry is assisting with the production of pigs through the piggery division of the Ebony Park Heart Academy in Clarendon. This state-of-the-art facility produces up to 125 pigs per month. Here, the selected breed of pig is raised in an air-conditioned-like temperature.
The type of animal is a cross between a Yorkshire and a Landrace. And what happens, we get a F1. So all the animals inside here, they are F1 gills. And this area is a cool area because we have a cool cell system. It operates like the AC system with the fans that assist it to move cool air through the pen, and it cools down the animal because pigs normally operate best at temperatures of 55 degrees Celsius.
The breeding process is done through artificial insemination, and this is done twice daily. A number is then given to the animal to represent the time at which it was bred. And within approximately 4 months, piglets are born.
This genetics, it is favored by most persons because you get a large litter size and the growth rate is very high. So you have litter size up to 17, and within 6 months times you have pigs growing up to 100 pounds and probably over.
Special care is given to these little ones. Within 24 hours after birth, they are processed. Their needle-like teeth are clipped to prevent them from hurting each other and their mother during feeding. The tails are also clipped for safety reasons, because you know they can easily pull on it or bite it during play. One aim of the facility is to produce infection and disease-free pigs. The males are also castrated to prevent breeding through natural contact. This piggery facility has three areas. First is the gestation or breeding area. 2 weeks before the gilts give birth, they are transferred to this section.
They spend normally 1 month around here, and when we wean the piglets, they go to the nursery area, and the sows go back to the gestation area to be bred again, and they normally come on to eat 5 to 7 days after they have been weaned or the piglets have been removed from them.
The last of the three areas is the nursery, and it does not have any cool cell system. The reason for this is to get the piglets adjusted to regular temperature in preparation for their transfer to other farms.
So when farmers buy them, they won't have any difficulty with them, or the animal won't be stressed, so they won't get slim or anything like that. And they normally spend 8 weeks here, and then they are shipped to other locations for fattening. Farmers buy them also for pig production.
The Ebony Park Heart Academy Piggery Division has been making a difference in the pig pork industry, supplying farmers with improved breed stock, contributing to agriculture and the economic development of the country.
This helps to sustain the pig industry by providing farmers with a production line, so they can always come to Ebony Park and buy pigs. Oh, and the turnaround time is really quick, so they benefit from it, and the profitability is great.
Know your numbers and control the keys to a healthier heart. Know the numbers for your blood pressure, cholesterol level, blood glucose level, and your weight and body mass index. Give yourself a fighting chance. Find out the risks they represent and what you need to do to stay healthy. Talk to your doctor and start making healthy lifestyle choices to prevent a heart attack or stroke.
As we observe Colon Cancer Month, we encourage you to do your regular checkups and screenings. Let's look closer now at what is colon cancer, its causes and symptoms.
Colon cancer is cancer of the large bowel. The large bowel is that area of the bowel which contains the waste products. Whenever you have colon cancer, it means that those cells are growing uncontrollably. And it's something that is very serious. It is a condition which you have to diagnose early, and so we can manage it appropriately. Once we diagnose colon cancer, the next step is to stage it. We want to know if it's confined to the colon or if it's outside the colon. So you're likely to have a CAT scan of the abdomen, a special x-ray, an x-ray of the chest, and some blood tests. We can use that information to decide if it's localized or if it's very involved. And that can help us to plan what your treatment is going to be. Colon cancer is very common in Jamaica in terms of cancers. We do know that it's the third most common cause of cancer-related death. So in males behind lung and prostate, in females behind breast and cervix. It accounts for maybe between 13 to 18 new cases per 100,000 per year in Kingston. And it may be even higher if you consider the entire island. The prognosis for colon cancer is very good, even though the numbers are very high. But the prognosis is good if you pick up the disease very early. So the earlier you detect colon cancer is the more likely you are to survive the condition. And that's why screening is important. Screening has been shown to reduce the incidence of death and complications from colon cancer. And we can use screening to actually prevent the development of cancer and treat. Stage 4 disease, however, if it's very late and has spread outside, only very low survival figures, as low as 20% would still be surviving by 5 years. So you do really need to pick up the condition very early, and that would be the best chance to improve your survival.
We've come to the end of today's show, but another informative program comes your way tomorrow. But you don't have to wait till then. Just connect to our website, jis.gov.jm. And while you're online, send your feedback to jamaicamagazine@jis.gov.jm or tweet at JIS News. On behalf of the entire production crew, I'm Adrian Atkinson. Walk good.
This has been a production of the Jamaica Information Service, the voice of Jamaica.